Fritz Aumann, born Friedrich Heinrich Karl Aumann on October 25, 1879 in Hanover and executed on April 15, 1925. He is the vampire of Hanover, or the butcher of Hanover. He is a German serial killer considered to be the author of the murders of 27 boys or young boys between 1918 and 1924. He was convicted of 24 murders and guillotined. The affair caused a scandal, especially since Aumann was a police informer. Indeed, Aumann had the appearance of a respectable man. Considered a petty delinquent in the past, he began to work as an informer for the police. This new job will have all its importance in his crimes, because they could easily manipulate and direct the police to bad leads to remove any worries. That's what caused the most scandal at the time. How the police got close to this serial killer, worse, how they were able to collaborate with without ever having the slightest suspicion of his activities. Back to what happened, we are in May and June 1924 when bones wash up downstream from the Lane River. It is a gruesome sight that the locals witness. The police decide to dredge the river and discover more than 500 human bones, later confirmed to come from at least 22 pupils. He was called the Vampire of Hanover for his modus operandi. In fact, Aumann killed his victim by beating them on the neck at the level of Adam's apple. Fritz Aumann was born in Hanover in 1879. He is the sixth child of poor parents, Johanna, Claudius, and of Olli Aumann. He is a calm child who shuns the activities of boys of his time, such as sport, and prefers a fun with her sister's toys, and even wear their clothes. He hated his father. His mother was not for nothing. In fact, Herman's father and his mother no longer loved each other. He even had a fairly substantial hatred for himself, the husband no longer supporting his wife's helplessness. He no longer wanted to do the housework or even the cooking, and she hated her husband, fickle, bossy and alcoholic. And she loved her children little except Fritz, whom she cherished. When his father, he could not stand the femininity of his son, he considered unnatural. Fritz preferred activities considered to be ladies at the time, needlework and women's work. The violence of his father, Fritz was the main victim, and he will never forgive how he treated him. Then Fritz's activities changed over time. He even amused himself by tying up his sisters. He didn't like school much. Fritz later allegedly claimed that at school he was sexually abused at the age of 8 by a teacher. He was a victim of school harassment, and his behavior would have changed more violently in his adolescence. No longer supporting what he lived within the school, but also at his house. At the age of 14, Fritz stopped school to start an apprenticeship to become a locksmith, but he still did not like it. So he joined the army in 1895 at the age of 15. Surprisingly, Fritz felt good in the army and played his role as a soldier. But after 5 months in the army, Fritz fainted during training and they detected a disease like epilepsy without knowing what Fritz was really suffering. Even today, the mystery remains unsolved. So he returned to live with his family in Hanover. With his father warm, he
hated so much. And he even went to work in his cigar company, father's cigar company. In addition, the army channeled his emotion and fixed him on a goal. Return to the social and unstructured world led him to behave more and more inadequate.
He went out late at night, watching young boys, most often lured them into cellars and dark places to sexually assault his victims. The victims did not file a complaint because at the time the embarrassment and shame was such that this subject was taboo. When he was 16, his father only suspected him of murdering a railway worker who accused him of abusing children. Oli Herman will denounce his son to a magistrate who will dismiss the case. But one day a young boy will explain his experience with Herman, and Fritz was arrested in 1896 and then in 1897 on the same charge. Fritz was then 17 years old. He was then examined by a doctor of psychology, and Fritz was diagnosed with incurable insanity and was interned in a psychiatric hospital May 28, 1897. But Fritz managed to escape and fled to Switzerland. He would work there for 16 months as a shipyard employee. But he returned to Hanover at the age of 20 under a false identity.
He had a relationship with a woman and a lover, but he continued a sexual assault on young men and had contact with the Hanover Mafia.
But Fritz returned to the army for compulsory service, having since no longer met any discomfort, and was placed in a battalion in Alsace. Very good marksman and soldier, all was well until 1901, when Fritz was again victim of another discomfort with loss of consciousness. He was hospitalized for 4 months, but the doctor still could not determine the cause of his Asthenian mental deficiencies. His seizures and his spoke meaninglessly, until he was transferred to another room, found to be diagnosed. Fritz was with schizophrenia. He was deemed unfit to continue in the army and become permanently disabled at the age of 22. He was forced to return to Hanover. His mother had died while Fritz serving in the army. Relations with his father were starting to get bad again, with his father accusing him of pretending to be sick so as not to work out of laziness. When in Fritz, he felt depressed for having returned to this life while in the army. Fritz expressed his dissatisfaction. His father will then file a complaint against his son, classified without follow-up. Fritz will then file a complaint in turn against his father for false accusations. But to avoid a conviction to their father, the brothers and sisters of Fritz have changed versions and sided with their father, accusing Fritz of threatening their father physically. Fritz subsequently became even more violent. His father subsequently demanded a re-examination of his son's sanity, which was accepted. This examination was conducted by Dr. André, who concludes that Arthur was morally inferior. Herman was not mentally unstable, but against all odds. In the years that followed, the father and son reconciled. His father even loaned money to his son and his wife Herna to open a fish shop that Herna managed, when in Fritz, after a letter from the army judging him totally unfit and in great disability, his pension increased.
But Herna, pregnant with Fritz, will break with him, making Fritz revive his old bad habits. In addition, the fishmonger shop was in the name of Herna. Fritz ended up with just his invalidate pension. He then continued his sexual assault, but also made burglaries and other thefts.
In close contact with the underworld of Hanover, he was often imprisoned for his delinquency from 1905 to 1913. He stole from his bosses, he assaulted, looted graves, and could not stabilize. But in 1913, then 33-year-old Fritz was imprisoned for 5 years, became calm and very cooperative. He worked in the mansion, and his bosses even appreciated the work of this prisoner. Released in 1918, he returned to Hanover and recommencing his crime again. He attracted younger men to his house, pretending to be a policeman, promising them a roof and a meal. They were often young men on the run or without families. When he succeeded in closing his trap, Fritz then sexually assaulted the young man. Fritz continued his trafficking and his theft in parallel. And it was at the same time that Fritz was recruited by the police as an informant, who nevertheless knew his penchant for children and his homosexuality, which was at the time punishable by imprisonment. Fritz, for example, was posing as a bourgeois so that the police could capture the smugglers. And so a relationship of trust was established between Fritz and the police, the latter thus letting him circulate freely and closing his eyes to his few petty crimes. The sector of this association was built mainly at the station. The police therefore authorized it to circulate there freely, which will allow Fritz to attract young male travelers without ever attracting any suspicion from the station employees, who knew that he was working with the police. But in September 1919, Fritz met Friedel, about 17, a young runaway who needed a place to take refuge. Fritz and Friedel had a special relationship. They had sex, but Aunt Friedel felt uncomfortable and, seeing Fritz a little more aggressive this time, refused his advances. Fritz got angry and raped Friedel, then beat him on the neck and snatched the Adam's apple from him. This was the start of Fritz's murderous passion. He will cut up Friedel's body and break his bones. Then, by making several trips, he will transport the pieces of corpse in a suitcase to the cemetery of Stoekener, where he would have buried the remains. But he would have kept the head, which he would have placed behind the gas stove. But after Friedel went missing, his friends reported him missing and explained to the police that the last time they saw their friend was with Hermann. When the police intervened at Fritz's home, he was in the company of a 13-year-old boy, half naked. He was then arrested for sexual assault, but the police would not have searched meticulously. They will not find the Friedel's head still hidden. He was sentenced to 9 months imprisonment, which he managed to not to serve immediately. At this time, he meets Hans Grunz, 18, who become his lover.
Shortly after, he was caught by the police and had to serve his 9 months prison sentence. Then he was able to become an informant again for the police. After an apology for his behavior on the pretext that he wanted to take control of his life.
1 year after the incident, he moved with Hans near the river called the Lane. Grunz and Fritz often quarreled. Fritz was sentenced for a burglary to work 6 months in a labor camp. On his return, he found his apartment ransacked and some belongings had disappeared. He later learned that the author of the theft was Grunz, but also that he had spent all the army pension checks that were intended for Fritz. Fritz would have kicked him out, but the next day, while Fritz was away, Grunz would have returned to the apartment to commit a final theft. In revenge, Fritz would have kidnapped and then killed a young man of 17 years and would have denounced Grunz as guilty. Mother body of the young man was discovered shortly with a handkerchief containing the initials of Hans Grunz. But Hans did not was unable to commit this murder because he was in pretrial detention at the time. Without proof, Fritz was not charged with this murder. Despite all this, the couple reconciled and they got back together. A few years later, the 17-year-old pianist Fritz Franke also disappeared on February 12, 1923. He had met Hermann at the station in Hanover. He would have taken Franke to his apartment after having joined Hans and two of his girlfriends. Then, after the departure of Hans and the girls, Fritz would have murdered Franke by beating him on the neck. When the next day, the two friends of Grunz returned to the apartment. They did not believe Fritz, who said that Franke had left because they had seen clothes of the victim still in the apartment. The two young women went to the police and reportedly made a statement to Detective Muller, the one who collaborated with Hermann as an informant. Fritz's apartment was searched the next day, but nothing was found and the investigation was stopped. After this second known victim, Fritz will continue his murder streak and will start selling contraband meat. This meat, which according to rumor could have been human remains. It was the turn of the apprentice writer Wilhelm Schulz, 17 years old on March 20, 1923, raped and then beaten on the neck. His remains were thrown into the Lane River near Fritz's apartment, like all the victims who followed. Then it was the turn of Roland Hutch, 16, a student who disappeared from the station on May 23, and Hans Sonnenfeld, 19, who disappeared the same month. The parents of Roland Hutch reported the disappearance of their child, but the report was not processed because the police had not taken it seriously.
Fritz and Grunz moved to another apartment because their old apartment attracted a little suspicion. Indeed, the neighbors started to talk and find Fritz suspicious. In addition, his meat was very suspicious.
Fritz diced the flesh and chopped it and always burned his fresh meat. In this era, surrounded by poverty, we threw ourselves on good opportunities. Fritz offered the population cheap meat. Many found it suspicious that Hermann entered his home without meat but left his home with his arms full of well-cut and wrapped meat. Until the day when an owner of one of the shops near Fritz's apartment questioned him to find out the origin of the meat he was selling. Fritz then stammered, "So this inhabitant of the neighborhood followed Hermann one evening and saw him throw a bag in the Lane River. The next day, he went to tell the police what he had seen. The police therefore returned to search Hermann's apartment, but once again they found nothing. Hermann was thoroughly cleaning his home. After Hermann moved in on June 25, 1923, 13-year-old Ernst Ehrenberg disappeared while away shopping for his parents. He never returned. Ernst was his neighbor's son. We can see here that the more he killed, the more he believed himself impregnable to the point of attacking victims very close. This feeling of power will continue thereafter. On August 24, the violinist Heinrich Strauss was the next victim. Besides, Fritz had kept his violin case. Paul Broniszewski, 17, disappeared while visiting his uncle on September 24, 1923. Still in that month, Richard Graf, 17, disappeared. Fritz had told him that he had found him a job. On October 12, 1933, Wilhelm Erdner, 16, disappeared with his bicycle from Hanover Station. For this disappearance, Fritz, still posing as a policeman named Honor Brock, arrested Wilhelm for lack of identity. But he did not take him to the police, but to his apartment. A witness of the arrest explained to the parents of the young man what had happened. They went to the police, who explained to them that there was no policeman with that name. Then again, in October, it was the turn of 15-year-old Hermann Wolf and 13-year-old Heinz Brinkmann. The latter had missed the train to return home. He trusted Fritz, who was still pretending to be a Polish man. Adolf Hanapel was the next victim, November 11, 1933. This apprentice carpenter of 70 years would have disappeared, but witnesses saw Grant in company of Hermann pointing the finger at Annabelle. Nobody will see Annabelle again after this meeting. On December 6, 1933, 19-year-old Adolf Ennis was looking for work. Fritz was the fatal encounter. On January 5, 1924, while Ernst Speaker, 17, was on his way to testify at the trial, Fritz came to meet him. Wanting to help him, he took him to his horror apartment. A man will kill Heinrich Koch, 20 years old, who was one of his acquaintances. In April 1924, he will kill Wilhelm Appel, 16 years old, who was going to work, as well as Robert Witzel, 18 years, and 1 month later, Heinrich Martin, 14 years, as well as Fritz Wittig, 17 years. This murder would have been ordered by Grants in Hermann, but we do not know the reasons. Still on May 26, 1924, Friedrich Abeling, aged only 10, was one of Fritz's victims, and unfortunately, the youngest. The last two proven victims of Fritz occurred in June 1924, 16-year-old Friedrich Koch and 17-year-old Heinrich de Vries tragically lost their lives at the hands of the vampire of Hanover. The remains of the last victim were found in a garden in Hanover, thrown into a lake at the entrance to the Ehrenhausen Gardens. It can be seen that Fritz did not hesitate to kill at least once a month and thereafter several times in the same month. This is because the more Fritz killed, the more confidence and experience he got. Fritz was a psychopath, disconnected from his actions.
He became too greedy and therefore became more reckless. Hermann called the act of beating the neck of his victims a love bite.
Sometime later, a skull was found by children. Then, even later, a bag of human bone was also found. Finally, after residents complained about the police not responding, the police will decide to dredge the river and discover more than 500 human bones, subsequently confirmed to come from at least 22 individuals. Everything led back to Hermann, given the number of witnesses who saw Fritz with several of the victims. But Miller, the one who collaborated with Fritz as an informer, had difficulty seeing Fritz, whom he saw fit as a bloodthirsty killer. The police tried to set a trap for Fritz at the station, but understanding this, Fritz named the young man as a suspect for misidentification by bringing him back to the officers to deflect suspicion of the murders and show that he was only doing his work. Except that this young man named Karl knew Fritz well, since he had already taken him to his apartment and even raped him, and he even threatened to kill him. Karl will then decide to tell everything to the police, which will lead the officer to search Fritz's apartment. Hermann was interrogated for a week, deprived of sleep and food. He will finally confess his misdeeds. When asked how many people he killed, he will answer somewhere between 50 and 70. However, the police only succeeded in incriminating him for 27 disappearances. Sometime later, a skull was found by children. Then, even later, a bag of human bone was also found. Finally, after residents complained about the police not responding, the police will decide to dredge the river and discover more than 500 human bones, subsequently confirmed to come from at least 22 individuals. Everything led back to Armand, given the number of witnesses, who saw Fritz with several of the victims. But Miller, the one who collaborated with Fritz as an informer, had difficulty seeing Fritz, whom he saw fit as a bloodthirsty killer. The police tried to set a trap for Fritz at the station, but understanding this, Fritz named the young man as a suspect for misidentification by bringing him back to the officers to deflect suspicion of the murders and show that he was only doing his work. Except that this young man named Carl knew Fritz well, since he had already taken him to his apartment and even raped him and even threatened to kill him. Carl will then decide to tell everything to the police, which will lead the officer to search Fritz's apartment. Armand was interrogated for a week, deprived of sleep and food. He will finally confess his misdeeds. When asked how many people he killed, he will answer somewhere between 50 and 70. However, the police only succeeded in incriminating him for 27 disappearances. The trial lasted barely 2 weeks, and a total of 100 witnesses testified. At his trial, Armand will declare, "Condemn me to death. I only ask for justice. I am not mad. Make it short. Do it soon. Deliver me from this life which is torment. I will not ask for mercy. I will not appeal either. I want to spend another happy night in my cell with coffee, cheese and cigars. After which I will curse my father and go to my execution as if it were a wedding." On December 19, 1924, he was found guilty and sentenced to death. Armand was guillotined on April 15, 1925 at 6 a.m. in Hanover Prison. His executioner was Karl Wappler. In accordance with German tradition, Armand was not informed of the date of his execution until the evening before. Upon receiving the news, he observed prayer with his pastor before being granted his last wishes of an expensive cigar and Brazilian coffee to drink in his cell. After his execution, Armand's head is preserved in a jar by scientists to examine the structure of his brain. It was kept at the medical school of Göttingen. One will find there traces of meningitis and an inflammation of the membranes of the brain which left after effect to Fritz. This can explain the discomforts during his life, but also some of his psychological problems. The head will be cremated in 2014. Unfortunately, this affair will have negative effects on homosexuals because they only put forward the homosexual side of Fritz and not his pedophilia, a wave of homophobia as in Germany. Indeed, the homosexuality was in the process of being decriminalized and the death penalty abolished. But with the Armand affair, everything got worse. Some media will even say that homosexuals were born killers. Homophobia was at its height. In 1924, a song was even created on the cover of the Note of the composer Walter Kolo on his song Wait Where Just a Moment Happiness Will Come. But following the episodes of the murders, people had fun changing the lyrics. And here they are, wait a little longer, a man will come and take care of you with his little hatchet, he will cut you into steak.
Warte, warte, nur ein Weilchen, bald kommt Hamann auch zu dir. Mit dem kleinen Hackebeilchen, mach da Hackefleisch aus dir.
Hope you liked this video. Feel free to subscribe.
Bye bye. See you soon in your nightmare.